Esteemed guests, Hafidh al-Quran, Ulama-Ikram, and our esteemed personnel here. Thank you for taking out the time to join us here today. I'm going to address the big lip in the room, right? So this morning I woke up with an allergy. My lips were swollen. I went to the doctor here. They gave me a whole lot of allergics. So I'm a little bit on the high side right now. Very bad to say in front of Ulama, but medicated. But please bear with me today as I will be your MC, inshallah. I think once again, Jazakallah for coming out today. We really appreciate it. We know you all have busy schedules, and we appreciate your time being here today. Inshallah, I'm going to ask Qari Bashir to start us off with a qiraat.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم محمد رسول الله والذين معه أشد أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم والذين معه أشداء على الكفار فار رحماء بينهم تراهم ركعا سجدا يبتغون فضلا من الله ورضوانا سيماهم في وجوههم من أثر السجود ذلك مثلهم في التوراة ومثلهم في الإنجيل كزرع أخرج شطأه فآزره فاستغلظ فاستوى على سوقه يعجب الزراع ليغيظ بهم الكفار وعد الله الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات منهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما صدق الله العظيم.
ما شاء الله جزاك الله for that karisab on last minute notice. I hope everyone has enjoyed the lovely meals that we have outside. Please, we have a lot more meals still out there if you guys are hungry, as well as a coffee cart that's going to be available throughout the afternoon, inshallah. Welcome to Al Baraka Bank's first Empower function. This function is created to assist our NPOs towards strategic objectives like corporate governance, banking solutions, amongst other. And we hope that every information that comes out here today is going to be fruitful for everyone. And we hope that if you have any questions, please feel free to ask any of our Baraka staff. And if you need anything on the hospitality side, please feel free to ask us as well. I'm now going to hand over to our COO, Mr. Mohammed Kaka, to do the official welcome.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and good afternoon. It's always a pleasure coming back home to Johannesburg, and I think the weather is nice and lovely as well. When we were getting ready, our Joburg team told us it's cold and get dressed up warmly, and then alhamdulillah, we've had a lovely day today. As Al Barakat, we have always been a community bank and your partner bank. Around 2 years ago, my team and I sat down and looked at how do we add value to our clients more than just sitting and doing it from a financial perspective. And we strategized and rolled out certain key products and programs. Some of them, the Woman in Business program has run successfully for 2 years. And alhamdulillah, this year, all I can say is watch the space. It's going to be phenomenal in the way that we're approaching it. Last year, we ran a program for accountants and auditors. And from that support, we identified a need to have a specific seminar, workshop, discussion for NPOs. We're not here to tell you how to raise money. You know how to do that your best. We're not here to tell you what are the risks associated in your particular areas and how to do disaster relief, etc. But what we can tell you is what we've seen over the 35 years as being a bank in South Africa. What are the challenges facing NPOs? How do we navigate it? How do you work with that? And what are some of the added values that we can bring into your organization? So as we navigate that this afternoon, please feel free to engage with the panel, ask questions, and make it an interactive session. Please also tell us what we can do to take this and make it better for the future seminars that we are going to be holding. This is the first one that we are holding in Johannesburg. It will be followed by events like this in Durban and in Cape Town. So if you are dealing with other NGOs, NPOs in those regions, we'll be seeing them, inshallah, in the future. Just before I finish, it is Al Baraka's 35-year celebration in South Africa. They say 30 years is a generation, and we now not only passed our first generation, but we're heading very much into our second generation, 5 years in. And for us, one of the biggest changes and drivers that has occurred in our second generation has been that of digitalization. The world as we know it has changed. What you can imagine is possible. And only what you can dream of is what is now going to be challenging. This morning, together with my team, we flew in and we were having breakfast downstairs and joined into a meeting around the approach where we as an organization have now been able to put robots side by side by humans. And these are not cyborgs, these are just automated processes, but they're called robots. And it's there to improve the way things happen, the way things are processed, the quicker turnaround times that we want to see in doing things. And as we went through that particular discussion, the team that were engaging or the business units that were trying to have their problem solved reached a point where the conversation ended in terms of what their understanding and their need was. And we pushed the boundaries a little bit further with them. And we said to them, but this is not where we want to stop. Our vision is actually a step forward. And we want to take this from what you've got and we want to take it a step forward by introducing a second robot. And we then moved the conversation into that second robot. And at the end of that second robot, the person from a business unit said, well, that's all great, but these people that do this and check up on this, they, in their work, you put a robot to do it. And the conversation then flowed into the use of artificial intelligence. And we all have seen ChatGPT, and we may understand that there's risks associated with ChatGPT. But the technology behind it, regenerative AI, gives an ability for decisioning, for somebody to be able to read a document. And I'm mentioning this particularly around NPOs and NGOs because you've got your customer base, the person applying for Zakat, the person applying for the grant, the person applying for that study loan. And somebody has to go through, edit up, analyze it, come back and say, this person's got a shortfall of X or Y. All of that today, as we stand, can be done through regenerative AI. And when we sort of put that out, the team said, oh, well, that's far-fetched, that's sci-fi. And the IT guys spoke and said, no, what he's talking of is not pie in the sky. It actually exists. We actually have it in our business, and we're running it at this moment in time. So the world that we know has changed. What computers and robots can't do is we have that human touch, that interaction. And that's what we want to do as Al Barakah Bank. We want to ensure that we are able to provide you that human touch, that interaction. But at the same time, we want to ensure that we streamline our processes and we do everything to ensure that it's least disruptive, it's least impactful in terms of friction, the least amount of friction in your day-to-day activities. I'm sure my team will talk to you about a lot of the services that we offer. One of the items that I'm very passionate about is we have found a way to move away from a voucher-based system into a card-based system. We've launched a product called the Social Responsibility Card. Nasser's nodding his head to tell me that it will be covered. And I think look at that in your areas of where you see value coming across as an NGO and an NPO. My last word is to introduce a 35-year video that speaks a lot about the digitalization journey that we've been on. We're not excited about what we've achieved in the 35 years. We're excited about what we, inshallah, will achieve in the next 35 and many more to come. So Jazakallah for attending. We hope you find the session interactive. We've got really an excellent team that are going to be presenting to you today, the moderator as well as the specialist. My interaction with the specialist has been from a client-banker relationship. We went across and we engaged with them on a number of activities. And you can see when people speak from an area of informed, an area where they're passionate about their business, and I'm sure they'll share that with you this afternoon, inshallah. With that, I introduce the video.
Jazakallah for that, Muhammad. And Alhamdulillah, I think you guys can see 35 years already, and the bank has done fantastic work, and may Allah continue to grow the bank from strength to strength. I'm going to start off with our first panel. I'm going to introduce our panel. Then after that, we'll have a second panel, followed by the vote of thanks and closure. Our first panel will be hosted by none other than well-known Zahira Bam. When I asked her for an intro, she was very biased and told me she has 28 years of experience in NPOs. But along with this, she's also a speech therapist, an audiologist, chairman of the Caring Women's Forum, and on the board of many other organizations. And I think she does fantastic work. And we are happy to have you as our panel host here today. With Zahira, we'll have two of the accountants from Turning Point Consultant Accountants. They are dedicated towards empowering nonprofit organizations through expert accounting, tax, and financial services. By optimizing financial management, they help NPOs increase efficiency and unlock valuable resources, enabling them to focus on their core mission. We welcome the Riza Amra and Farida Lavangi from Turning Point Accountants. Welcome to come through.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And it's such a pleasure to be here. I think I'm becoming part of the furniture at Al Baraka Bank. I'm here so often. I think on behalf of everyone sitting in this audience, and I recognize many faces as part of the NPO field and sector currently in Johannesburg, I think the one thing we take for granted is if something has worked, just stick with it and let it work and let it continue. But if you're any part of finance, we realize governance and corporate governance, especially in compliance, is really changing. And it's time we need to adapt to that to be able to keep out the longevity of our organizations. So many organizations, we think we've been there for years. It's been well intentioned. We've got good intentions to do good work around the community and to impact the community. But it's more than good intentions now that counts. It's about corporate governance. It's about ethical responsibility. It's about transparency. It's about making sure that we are protecting and safeguarding not just ourselves or our donors, but our beneficiaries, our rights holders. And this becomes important for us to be able to understand how our roles are and how we play out those roles and understanding our responsibilities as well as our obligations. I'm very honored to be with my esteemed guests today. When I spoke to them earlier this week, I think I said to Nasser, there's no way this can be a 45-minute discussion. So I'm hoping that Al Baraka decides to turn this into something longer later. And when you hear this conversation, you'll understand exactly why. I know we're stuck for time, so we're going straight into this. The formalities have been done. Jazakallah, everyone, for joining us today. Farida and Riza, I think you've brought the warm Durban winter to us, so jazakallah for that. We thank you for that as well. I think when we talk about NPO work, many of us think, oh, you know what, we know NPO, NPC, PBO, Section 18, these words are constantly flying around. Just to go back to basics, in terms of understanding, what does this mean in terms of compliance when it comes to organizations?
Firstly, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and jazakallah, and thank you for your support this afternoon. Thank you to Al Baraka to put something like this together as well. And most importantly, for you all to sacrifice your time. You know, it's quite limited as well in terms of running a non-profit organization. But as you rightly pointed out, I think, you know, the terms that get thrown about becomes quite complex for organizations to understand. You know, where do we fit in this entire jargon and terminology and the complexities of it all? But if we go back to the building blocks, you know, like you'd have with a business, where businesses would operate via a PTY Limited or in the previous days as a closed corporation, as nonprofit organizations, there's three structures within which an organization can be housed. So you have to be operating either as a nonprofit company, which is the old Section 21 company, a nonprofit trust, or voluntary association. Very frequently when we go out and we ask an organization, okay, so what's the legal structure that you're housed within? The first response is we're an NPO. You know, but your NPO in the technical sense of the term is your registration with the Department of Social Development, which gives you your NPO number. Now each of those structures, you know, whether you're a nonprofit trust, a nonprofit company, or a voluntary association, is governed by different pieces of legislation. So your nonprofit company will be governed by the Companies Act, your nonprofit trust by the Trust Properties Control Act, and then lastly, your voluntary association is actually the common law itself. So it is quite important to understand where you fit in, so you as an organization understand which rules and regulations applies to your organization.
Perfect. And I think, you know, with many of the donors always calling in to want to donate, everyone wants a Section 18. Tell me about what the significance of the Section 18 is and why NPOs should actually look to getting that done.
Yeah, I think especially with all that's been going on in the past year and a half, with all the changes with legislation in terms of the additional requirements with the Section 18A receipts that many of you are aware of, the recently introduced IT3D submissions, which we'll hopefully touch on later on as well. But essentially what an 18A does for an organization is that it actually encourages donations to your organization because of the fact that your donor actually benefits from a tax deduction in their income tax returns. So to give you an example, a simple one, as it may be, if someone's earning 200,000 Rand a year and they've perhaps donated 10,000 Rand to your organization, if you are 18A approved, then instead of paying taxes on 200,000 Rand, the donor obviously then pays taxes on 190,000 Rand. So there is a tax saving to the organization. It applies to both donations in kind and in cash, but not to donations of services. I think that's an area that causes quite a bit of confusion. Very often we find that organizations get it wrong as well in terms of issuing out 18A receipts for perhaps fundraising dinner tickets that are sold. And we've seen it previously on an advert that goes out where they do advertise that for the ticket sale, you'll be entitled to an 18A receipt. But I think we were chatting about it earlier on where we said time is of an essence. We're not going to be able to unpack everything, but I think what's important is just to be aware of the basics today, to go back and ask the relevant questions within your organization as well. Because even 18A, we actually host, you know, 2 hour or 3 hour sessions just unpacking what it means to be an 18A registered PBO.
I think that's an important point, and I do hope if we don't get to touch on it here, we do touch on it at some point, that your Section 18A certificates, you are very limited as to what you can allocate that for. I know that because my treasurer always gives me a lecture when I promise that.
In fact, that's an excellent point, and I think especially with, if I could call it, faith-based organizations, which obviously most of our Muslim organizations have started off in some form or the other, you know, whether it's through a masjid or running a madrasa, and eventually it evolves over a period of time to a fully fledged humanitarian organization. And remember, 18A doesn't apply to all your activities. So likewise, with regard to the legislation in terms of public benefit activities to determine whether you are registered as a public benefit organization, your 18A listing is quite restricted. Just to make it as easy as possible, I think some of the activities that are excluded from 18A, if you are doing work internationally, so if there's relief work that's being done in another country, for instance, then you cannot issue an 18A receipt for that. Likewise, for any religious work, whether it's maintenance of a masjid or a madrasa as well, sports and arts and culture. So those are the four big areas which you shouldn't be issuing out 18A receipts. So it is quite important to have your house in order and able to identify which of your activities does qualify for 18A.
I'm coming back to touch on that. Maybe Farida, if you want to just add to it, one of my questions, and maybe you can we can actually bring it in now, is how does that impact on zakah funding?
Okay, so that's quite important because a lot of organizations out there are issuing these 18As for non-18A activities, generally because there's a lack of understanding or a knowledge of what is allowed, what you can use the 18A for. So with zakah funds, you can use it so, if you're buying, like, for example, maybe using it to buying food and groceries and you donating that on, that would be allowed. You just obviously have to look at it, what's excluded, and generally, like Riza said, it's like your religious activities, so the madrasa, the masjid, those sort of things. But if you are doing welfare work with the zakah money, you can actually issue the 18A with that.
Perfect. I know that with many of us, when we started in NPO work, it was a while ago, the rules were very simple. The legislation has changed quite considerably over the years. Where are we sitting currently in terms of legislation for NPOs?
Okay.
I'll go with the big change, which I think most organizations here today have obviously been aware of, and I think it's called quite a bit of confusion in the sector as well, is in terms of the changes to 18A receipt requirements. As you were aware, from the 1st of March 2023, there's additional fields that have come in where you're required to put in your donor's ID number, potentially even the income tax number if you have the details. There's quite a laundry list, I'd call it, in terms of the information that needs to be put on there compared to previously. But this was just a prelude to what was to come in terms of the IT3D submissions. To simply put it, you know, if you recall, I know when I first started working, we used to still, without giving my age away, we used to still complete your tax returns or manually. You know, you'd go on, you complete it, go down to the SARS branch and put it into those little boxes on the outside. Likewise with your medical aid receipts, you know, it's the same thing, or your medical aid claims, you'd have to input that into your tax return. And then we evolved over a period of time to e-filing, and then your EMP 501 submissions, where that information is now pre-populated on the donor's income tax return. So what SARS has now done as part of their modernization program is that they've put the onus on you as an organization to provide them with that information through the IT3D submission. What that enables SARS to do is that it allows them to now pre-populate a donor's income tax return with the donation amount that was obviously made to your organization. Because of the amount of obviously fraud that's happened over a period of time as well, you know, there's obviously unscrupulous donations that are being claimed and that sort of thing. So SARS have obviously clamped down on that aspect. And I think this is probably the biggest change in terms of the sector itself over the past year or year and a half as well. And, I mean, again, it's quite a minefield in terms of getting that submission done itself. But we are around after this. If there's any questions, we're more than happy to field those questions on one.
I am going to follow up on that. But Farida, I just want to ask you, before I ask about submissions and that, how do we remain compliant with the current tax regulations? Because very often you'll hear an NPO saying, I'm tax exempt. I don't need to pay taxes.
So maybe I'll talk a little bit about myself. 7 years ago, I had no idea anything about the NPO space. I came from corporate. My only understanding of it was that it was the free work that we got given to do when we were in articles, you know? and then I started working with Reza and them, and then you understand the sector and you understand all of the compliance. And when we meet clients, that statement, because you ask them, okay, so are you up to date with all of your taxes? And they're like, well, we are tax exempt, purely because they're a PBO. Mm. They throw that out to say they're tax exempt, but PBO status only is linked to income tax. There's all the other taxes. Obviously, there's employee taxes, which most nonprofit organizations have employees. I mean, that's the most common compliance that you're going to have. If you've got employees, you've got to be submitting returns to SARS. So that's on a monthly basis. And then, like Reza mentioned, you have the EMP 501. Then you've got VAT, obviously, which a lot of nonprofits don't know that they can actually register and claim back VAT from SARS, that's Reza's department. But it's actually, I mean, that's money that you can get back from SARS, so people don't know about that. And then there's a whole lot of other compliance. So if we talk about non-SARS related, one of the biggest things that came about last year was when South Africa got put into grey listing. Mm-hmm. And most people would think it wouldn't impact nonprofits at all, but it was actually aimed at nonprofits because when the country was put into grey listing, one of the things they identified is that nonprofits could be used as a money laundering operation or for terrorist financing. And with that, a whole lot of laws came about. They changed, introduced new acts. They also made amendments. So if you're sitting here and if your organization is a trust, there's new amendments that have been made to the Trust Property Control Act. There's also been amendments made to the Companies Act and to voluntary associations. There's lots of things that you have to comply with. One of it, which is I think the biggest thing that affects a lot of our Muslim organizations, is that previously registration with Department of Social Development was purely voluntary. But when this was introduced, they said, if you are doing international work, so if you are doing relief work outside of South Africa, which a lot of our organizations are doing, it's now mandatory on you to register with the Department of Social Development and comply with obviously all of their requirements. So there's obviously that aspect. So besides, most people think compliance, yes, there's SARS, but there's also lots of other things. So Department of Labor is another one, but we don't have time to go into all of it, obviously.
No, I think that's an important thing to mention, because very often we find people, especially during Ramadan, everyone wants to just go out and do work in communities and not realizing organizations have been there throughout the year. And this is something I think we have to send a message back to everyone, that if you're not registered, you really cannot be giving your money there, because there's so much of scrutiny, and especially at a time when we know Muslim organizations are being looked at a little bit more closely in terms of how funds are going through. So all those cash donations now need to stop. Farida, you mentioned in terms of the different codes and legalities that are coming in, and there's one in particular in terms of the Code of Corporate Governance. How does that apply to NPOs?
So I think maybe we should first start with what is corporate governance. So it's in South Africa, we've got what's called the King IV Report on Corporate Governance. It's basically a code that's focusing on how an organization or a company can actually be have effective leadership, can be transparent to its stakeholders, and the definition of a stakeholder is quite broad. But it focuses on those areas. Now, it's mandatory in South Africa for listed entities to apply the corporate governance code, but they do have what's called an NPO charter. So a lot of nonprofits can actually apply the King Report of Corporate Governance, and I think it's actually quite important for a nonprofit to apply these principles purely because you're dealing with other people's money. Mm. You are responsible to your donors for reporting to them, so you need to have the proper structures in place to ensure that your board obviously is leading the organization effectively, that the board is aware of what is expected of them, which I know is another thing I come across as an auditor in the nonprofit space. Most of the time, board members don't understand what's required of them, what's their roles, what's their responsibilities for the organization itself, what risks they're taking on as a board member. So I think as a nonprofit, very important to familiarize yourself with these different legislations that's out there, using the term legislation very loosely because it's not mandatory, but to see how it can apply to you as an organization. Yes, not everything in the corporate governance is going to be applicable, but things like effective leadership, every organization needs that. Things like proper board structures and roles and responsibilities, any organization, irrespective of your size, you need that, right? So you obviously have to take from it what is applicable to you as an organization itself. Some of it may not be relevant, but a lot of it would be.
And are these easily accessible? How are people able to access this information?
You can actually just Google it. It is available online. Like most information, I think Mohammed mentioned digitization. And I think the NPO space, which we see, a lot of organizations very passionate about what they want to do and about the work that they want to do for the community. So that aspect, their programs run excellent. They put in all of the processes. Brilliant. But what happens on the finance and admin, it's still stuck in the 1990s or the 2000s, and it has not evolved with how technology has evolved. So I think that's also, obviously, all of this information is available online. Or you could contact us for assistance with those sort of issues.
Yeah, you know that you'll be called on.
I just want to add to that. I think over and above, you've got King, but you've also got the NPO Code of Good Governance, I think it's called, that's also available online. And that's now specific to nonprofit organizations. We find that many organizations are unaware of that. I think it was actually spearheaded by a civil society organization down in Cape Town called Inyotelo. So if you go online, you'll be able to find that as well. Quite practical tips and tools in terms of being able to implement within your organization.
And what's nice about having access to things like that, you can easily add it into your constitution, which actually you need for about everything that you need to do legally these days. Just coming back to 18A and IT3 mandatory submissions, how are we able as NPOs to prepare and manage for these submissions?
Okay, so the most important thing is to obviously go back to your 18A receipts and ensure that you are meeting those requirements for the additional fields, because without that information, you will not be able to submit the IT3 data to SARS. Just on a side note, whilst it has made mention of the income tax number, it isn't mandatory for now, but I think there will come a time where it eventually does become mandatory. So the important thing is to obviously communicate to your donors so they are aware as to why you're requesting this information. I think that's been one of the biggest challenges, is getting the information from donors. They're resistant or reluctant to share that information with organizations. So that's the first part of it. Thereafter, what you need to ensure is that your organization is registered as a third-party data provider with SARS, or you do have what's called a third-party submitting entity. Because remember, as a third-party data provider with SARS, this is what now allows you to provide the information on behalf of your donors to SARS themselves. And then critically is ensuring that the data is in applicable format. The reason being is that if you've issued 50 or less 18A receipts for the year, the 1st of March 2023 to the 29th of Feb 2024, you can submit this via e-filing, via what's called an IT301 and an IT302, right? If you have issued more than 50 18A receipts, then it's an additional platform that SARS has introduced, which is called HTTPS, and you would need to register to actually get a secure link to upload that information to SARS via a specific data file itself. Yes, I know it's a lot to take in, but there is a bit more information on our website as well, so you can go out and we've got a quick video there. There's an infographic as well, but as Faiza mentioned, you can speak to us after as well if you've got any specific questions.
I know it seems overwhelming, and especially for people in the NPO field, our job is we just want to go out and do good work. But the truth of it is that good work has to be paired with following legalities to ensure that our organizations don't get closed down. So as Reza mentioned, this information is available. And if it does seem overwhelming, just get your finance people to get in touch with them and they'll be able to break it down for you a little bit easier.
I recall Shabir mentioned, I think that we hosted a workshop in Durban, and Shabir mentioned that I think the Al Baraka team, you've got a team who spent 3 months just to get ready for the IT3 submissions as well. So it's the same process that nonprofit organizations have to follow, like a large corporate bank as well, or even a medical aid company. So just bear that in mind. I think it's important to get that. The risk with not submitting is that your donors, whilst for the 2024 tax year, donors will still need to input the donation amounts into the income tax returns. But going forward, it will be pre-populated. So there is a risk that your donor might not get the deduction if the information is not submitted to SARS.
So basically, we're looking forward to Al Baraka workshopping that on behalf of NPS.
Yeah, maybe
so
we need to get the team on board to help us a bit
Inshallah.
As well.
In terms of audits, why are audits so important and what do they entail?
Okay, so let's start with the fact that there's different types of
audits,
right?
Which I was going to go into. Tell me the difference between the statutory and the donor audits.
Okay, so I'm going to start first with something that we didn't actually raise with you. So often I get called and said, okay, I need audited financial statements. So the first question I ask, okay, and I'm thinking now, this is a small organization, so I can't understand why they would want audited. So I ask, okay, please send me the last set of financial statements. And what do I get? I just get a compilation, which, just to explain, is basically, it's not signed off by an auditor. There's very few people in the country that can sign off on an audit. So number one is that the term audit is used so loosely that people think they're getting an audit, and it comes back to lack of understanding, lack of knowledge. So they think they need an audit, and so they ask for an audit. But if we go back to now, why do you need an audit, and when do you need it? So you have a statutory audit, which is governed in terms of the Companies Act of South Africa. And obviously, if your trust deed allows, requires it, or if your constitution requires it, then you have what's called a mandatory audit. So that's a statutory audit where the auditors come in. Again, it has to be a registered auditor, somebody who's registered with IRBA. So it's not just anybody. It's not an easy designation that you can get in the country. There's actually very few at the moment. It's dwindling, the number. So that person will audit your last set of financial statements. So we look at the year that's passed. There's a lot of, obviously, compliance work that we've got to look at. We've got to comply with our auditing standards. So we're giving assurance to somebody who's reading your financial statements that these financial statements are fair. There's nothing materially wrong with it, right? So that's a statutory audit. Then you get what's called a donor audit, which is very common for organizations that have international donors. So I'm registered, I'm an accredited USAID auditor. Again, very, very restricted, very few people in the country that are registered. So we do quite a bit of those where the USAID, you're obviously complying with USAID guidelines. So you're auditing that specific grant. So a donor audit looks at a specific project, a specific donor's grant itself, and then they vary in terms of what you would do because your donor would specify what procedures they want, to the extent that some may say what percentage coverage they require of verification. Whereas in a statutory audit, we guided by the auditing standards, so it's slightly different. So that's essentially the difference between the two. Obviously, the donor audit as an organization, number one, if your donor requires it, then you have no choice. You've got to get that done. It obviously gives your donor comfort that you as an organization are spending the money in accordance with the terms of your grant agreement, which is another important thing. Most people don't read those grant agreements properly. I had an audit client where they lost their funding in year two, and it was a huge US grant. They lost it in year two because the finance person never read the grant agreement, so they weren't complying with a whole lot of simple things. So very important is understanding what's in the grant agreement, knowing whether your donor wants an audit or not. And that, again, it will lead to future funding. So if your donor is happy with you, they're happy with the donor audit that they're getting, they're obviously gonna be more likely to provide you with funding in the future. Similarly, with the statutory audit, obviously donors would look at these financial statements. Another important thing, national lottery. So if people are applying to them for funding, previously you didn't require audited financial statements. It's now a mandatory requirement that they want you to be audited. So again, if you're going funding for certain organizations, you might need one, even though you don't qualify for one in terms of the Companies Act or your founding documents don't require you to have one.
Okay. I think, and that's another whole topic to unpack just on its own. Reza, earlier you mentioned something that I think every NPO loves hearing is how we get our money back. Tell me a little bit about how VET impacts NPOs in South Africa.
Okay, so I think I'll just take it a step back before we actually unpack VET a little bit. You know, just to reiterate, I think what was mentioned early on in terms of your public benefit organization status, which we obviously all refer to as your PBO status from SARS. Very often, you know, the first response is, but we tax exempt because we've got that PBO status or that PBO letter from SARS. Yes, you do get 18A PBO status as well. But remember, that PBO status merely gives you a partial income tax exemption and possibly some exemption or some benefits from other taxes like donations tax. There's benefits from capital gains tax. You could be exempt from transfer duty if you purchase a property for your organization, skills development levy in certain instances as well. So there's a whole host of taxes that you obviously could have special dispensations afforded to your organization. However, if you look at that letter, it mentions nothing about VAT. And if you think about it, even you and I as individuals are not exempt from VAT. You know, if we go out and we purchase, whether it's a laptop or clothing or anything, we're paying VAT on that. And likewise, nonprofit organizations pay VAT. I can assure you, if we go into a Makro store, the Makro store manager is not going to say to you, okay, we won't charge you VAT because you're a PBO. It'll never happen. You can try, but it'll never happen. And very often we hear that we're VAT exempt, but there's actually no concept as VAT exemption itself. So nobody is exempt from VAT. However, as public benefit organizations and certain categories of public benefit organizations, again, it's not a blanket benefit that's available, you could qualify as a welfare organization to register for VAT if you are undertaking what's called welfare activities. Again, it's quite a specific list, similar to your 18A list, which is restrictive. The organizations that are excluded from registering for VAT is if you are undertaking religious activities, which obviously most of our organizations need to be aware of, sports and arts and culture. The reason being, if you think about it, those are not really government's priority areas. Mm. Government's interested in healthcare, education, skills development, poverty alleviation, disaster relief, all of those things are their mandates and a mandate of any government. So that's the reason why you've got the additional benefit of VAT. Now, what that allows you to do is, remember, your donation income does not attract any VAT. So unlike a business, for instance, when we bill for the fees that we charge our clients, we have to charge them VAT. And then we net off the VAT that we claim on our costs and we pay it over to SARS. As a nonprofit organization, again, I'm going to put a simple example to you. If you've got R1 million donation, right, and there's no other income, there is no output VAT that's paid on that R1 million donation income. However, you've got other costs, whether it's rental, utilities, bank charges, which hopefully will be quite minimal if you're banking with Al Baraka. Right?
Speak to Al Baraka.
And then you've obviously got your project costs, computer equipment, and I mean, the list is endless, stationery. All of those costs have an element of VAT, and that's 15%. So let's assume, I'm going to do easy numbers because as accountants, we've gotten so accustomed to Excel that we can't do calculations in our head. So we'll say, let's assume it was 115,000 Rand. Or better still, let's make it 1,150,000 Rand. And most organizations obviously, you know, don't have surpluses at the end of the year. And let's assume all of it is VATable cost. There's no salaries and wages. We'll give it a simple example. So you're potentially losing 150,000 Rand VAT if you're not registered for VAT in that year, if all of those costs were VATable. So just by being registered for VAT, you can obviously now claim back those refunds on a bi-monthly basis, and SARS becomes a donor to your organization. Obviously, you have to keep certain records in place and that sort of thing, but again, that's, you know, a topic for another day, but it's a huge benefit, and we find significant leakage in terms of VAT, because there's extra dispensations that are available to you as the nonprofit sector with regard to VAT compared to other businesses as well. So if you are not VAT registered, you should be asking the question as to why you're not, because it's a huge, huge benefit. And remember, it's an injustice to your donors by you not being VAT registered, because what happens is your donor monies are not going the full mile, and you've probably as an organization got shares in Kandla for all I know. So yeah.
But Rita, just on that, you have to be a PBO, right?
Yes, that's quite important. It has to be, you have to be a PBO to qualify for that registration.
The reason I raise that is that we come across lots of organizations who aren't even registered with SARS. So I think that's the first part, is obviously getting your organization registered as a PBO, because most people will say they're a nonprofit. So They don't need to register for anything. Mm. So they don't even register with SARS for income tax, because the process is income tax, then PBO, and then you can do a VAT registration. So the organizations that's sitting here, it's just important to understand, what are you registered for, or is your organization even registered at point one, which is for income tax itself?
So NPO, income tax, then your PBO, and then your VAT.
Yeah. That unlocks it, yeah. Your PBO status basically unlocks all of your tax benefits.
Yeah.
So there's no benefit from, you know, registering with the Department of Social Development as an NPO. There's no tax benefit. It gives you credibility, perhaps certain discounts as well. Mm-hmm. But I think your tax benefits start flowing from your PBO status. Just as a side note as well, for those that are not VAT registered, all is not lost. There is a possibility that you could go back retrospectively as well and register from a historical date. And each organization is unique in terms of how far back one can go. And it can become quite a significant saving to the organization in terms of that historical recoupment of the VAT. It is quite a specialized area again. And we find that even the SARS consultants, we work with organizations across the country, I've even been through local branches. And even the SARS consultants, remember, they're not dealing with public benefit organizations on a day-to-day basis. Mm. I've actually had to go in with the VAT legislation many years ago to show them that this is the legislation as it applies to a non-profit organization. Because the first question you're going to get, have you reached your threshold of 1 million rand, which only applies to businesses and not to non-profit organizations.
So just following up on that, just some practical tips in terms of managing our VAT obligations more effectively.
So for those of you that are VAT registered, I think, like Mohammed pointed out earlier on, you know, the world is changing, and it's changing at a rapid pace. In terms of the technology out there, there's tools available to your organization. I mean, if you are still using desktop software, then you're way, way behind. And again, desktop software is obviously old legacy software where you have to download specific software and back up your files and manually capture data. And I always maintain that, and Fariza had a client who used to still have the old for those
not
accountants.
Have. Or still have. They're still
writing.
I was going to say, you're talking about desktop. Some of us are still working on books and paper.
But he was so meticulous, in terms of recording his income and expenditure, your old cash book, your ledgers. But I always maintain, what's changed if all we're doing is we inputting that data into a laptop or a computer, but still manually capturing it from a PDF document? Then he's probably better and faster at doing it because he's been doing it for so many years, compared to if you're using technology like OCR, optical character recognition, from extracting data from your supplier invoices, using automatic bank feeds. So we're huge advocates for Xero, which is a leading cloud-based platform. I've just come back from a conference in the UK, and to see where technology is going, where they're now amalgamating AI into that software, which will now obviously actually undertake certain sort of processes for you automatically. So that's a starting point, is to first assess in terms of your financial accounting, are you working efficiently in terms of extracting and processing the data for VAT? For instance, you get a supplier invoice sent to you by Telkom. If you're manually inputting that VAT amount into your accounting system, then you are wasting time, because what you could do using the tools available is that information gets automatically extracted and gets taken to your VAT control account, which is showing how much of VAT SARS owes to you. And then thereafter, you can actually submit that return directly from a platform like this, which integrates into e-filing. So your risk of human error is also minimized in terms of that VAT return, because that data now pulls through automatically into your VAT return itself. And all your documents that SARS would require is now already available to you on this cloud-based accounting platform. So even if you are going through a SARS verification audit in terms of the VAT itself, you're ready for it, because all of your invoices are saved online. It's a matter of just then uploading it to SARS, as opposed to having to go and pull out your file, scan it, upload it. And then it's a matter of ensuring that once that's submitted, is monitoring the time frame within which SARS has to pay out that refund. SARS are legally obliged to pay out that refund within 21 days of you submitting the information to them. And we find many organizations, VAT refunds are delayed, which impacts their cash flows. And believe me, if you go back and look at the numbers, it's significant amounts that organizations obviously have trapped with SARS. Then ensuring that VAT refunds get paid out. If it doesn't get paid out on time, then by that 22nd day, you want to escalate and make sure that those VAT refunds get paid out timely.
Mm.
just on the VAT refunds, I think one important thing for organizations and people sitting in finance is tracking that, but also looking at whether SARS is raising any correspondence. Often we meet a client, and I just had one now, we took on their work, and I was looking at the VAT statement of account for the last 3 years, and I realized SARS raised assessments for over 300,000 of their refunds, and the previous accountant, which was in-house, wasn't aware of it, and ISO management is not aware of it. So there's about 300,000 that's sitting there. So obviously point to them in the direction of Visa and said, listen, get him to go in and look at your backlog, because you can get that money back. But often, those refunds are not being paid out, one, because nobody is aware that SARS has raised any request for data, or they're not aware of what has to be submitted to SARS because they are specific requirements. And then, like Lisa said, tracking that 21 days. But it comes down to, obviously, again, being aware of what is it that you need to be doing, what information you need, and whether you have that information available. So,
you know, as much as it seems overwhelming, I think once we get into the systems and we become more efficient as organizations, yeah, this is better flowing. But having said that, with efficiency, there's a lot of mistrust with regards to cloud-based products or technology coming in. And especially for us, who've been in this for so long, a lot of our relationships are based on trust. It's based on word of mouth. It's based on pen and paper. How do we make those transitions? How easy it is to now say, I'm putting it into a cloud-based system. I need to know these are the right programs to be using as an NPO, that my database won't be compromised or my information won't be compromised.
Yeah, so I think, I mean, that's quite a valid concern. I think, and most of us today have that, obviously, concern in terms of your data being on this cloud. Where is this cloud, where is it housed? Even when we first heard about Xero as a product, it took us a good few years to actually transition over. And eventually, when we did, we haven't looked back ever since because of the benefits that it's brought. I always maintain, living in South Africa, I think there's more of a risk that your data is actually going to get stolen from your office or your car than the cloud. So that's, I think, the first point that we need to keep in mind. But most of these platforms, on a more serious note, I think they have, encryption in terms of bank-level security. And I think we've got the experts in-house here as well in terms of that government-level security. If you're going with a reputable platform, then generally you're going to find that they go through security audits as well. So your data is not compromised in any way. Because remember, those platforms are dependent on, obviously, you and ensuring that your data is secure. Because then it's a business risk for them if your data is not secure, and it obviously impacts their business itself. So a lot of them go through and have, obviously, your big four audit firms who conduct security audits, and they do obviously get sign off on that as well. So yeah, I think security, if you're going with a reputable service provider in terms of the platform itself, it should never be a concern for your organization. Okay.
You mentioned Xero a few times. Can you mention a few other ad hoc cloud solutions for NPOs?
So I'll leave Farida to maybe touch on a payroll solution, which works pretty well, called SimplePay, which is something that we use as well. But there's quite a few out there. And as a firm, I think we've been, because of all the changes, we've embraced technology as much as we can. Over and above just cloud-based or working and meetings, which has been a problem getting me back into the office because I've gotten so accustomed to that. But there's quite a few. There's project management tools, and a lot of it is free. A lot of it, there's free tools available to nonprofit organizations and are used by large international corporates as well. So it's secure platform. So there's something that we use. I'm going to touch on some of the stuff that we use, because we know that it works and works pretty well. So there's a project management tool called Asana. So tasks can be raised on there. You get daily reminders on there. You can collaborate with your team on there. So even with us, I think we try to move away from email as much as possible, because I think email communication is more two-way. But with regard to the project management tool, it's all about collaboration. You're working with different teams, individuals from different departments. So if you've got a fundraising project underway, you need to get the guys involved from marketing. The guys that are doing the event management itself, those guys that are actually going out with donor relationships. You need to get different individuals involved on a specific project, and someone needs to have oversight, or they need to know what's happening, across the spectrum. And something like that now gives you insight into that tool. You've even got design tools. There's a platform called Canva. Whether it's presentations, whether it's your social media flyers that you want to create, whether it's logos for your organizations, you know, you don't necessarily then have to engage with the designer to do all of that for you. Setting up appointments, you know, you can give access to someone to actually have access or within your team or even externally to your calendar. So if they need to book a meeting, they can go on onto this platform, have access to your calendar and book that meeting. So that's called Calendly. You know, there's just a few of it, but believe me, there's so much out there. You know, there's quite a bit which organizations can use. We've recently launched a platform called 10 Bucks Only. It's an online fundraising platform where your organization can showcase what they do, you know, which allows then donors to search for your organization either by your organization name, your location, or even in terms of your activities, and then donate directly to your organization commission free. And that donation comes directly to your organization, and then it fully automates the 18A receipting process and also then assists with the ITCD submission as well. You know, so that's obviously now really changes the way we fundraise, because we find many organizations, you know, struggle with showcasing what they do online and using technology. Even finding their banking details online becomes a bit of a challenge. You know, so that's just a few in a nutshell itself. Fraser will just maybe touch on SimplePay as a payroll solution.
So just before we go to SimplePay, just you asked if there's anything else besides Xero. So obviously we use Xero, but we also work with other, where clients use software such as Sage Online. But I have to say, I mean, I've worked on both. We've come from pastel days where chalk and cheese. So pastel is way past. If your organization is still in pastel, please go and Google Xero or Google Sage Online. There are NPO discounts as well available to your organization. So you're not gonna be stuck with the full fee that a normal entity would be paying. So there's Sage Online, there's also Zoho that I've seen, but in terms of functionality and user friendliness, I would say Xero is far and it's definitely above those. From a payroll solution, so we've also come from the days of VIP, and Visa used to hear me complaining every year just before EMP 501 submission dates. No matter how long I told our staff, I am not reviewing on the 31st of May, but what would happen? 4 o'clock, I'm still reviewing on the 31st of May, because there was always issues. There was drama with VIP, something was wrong with the backup, it wouldn't integrate with the SaaS system, so it was always a nightmare. And Visa is our tech savvy guy at the office, so he's always finding the tech for us, and I just implement. We found something called SimplePay, and we sat through a whole lot of other payroll software solutions. So if your organization is looking for something that's easy, simple, it's cloud-based, I can access it from my phone, you can really look at that. It's cheap. The 501 process, we were 2 weeks ahead of deadline this year, which has been unheard of, and we do about 40 organizations EMP 501 submissions. So to be 2 weeks ahead was insane for us, coming from where I was working up until 4 o'clock on the 31st every year. So SimplePay definitely is a tool. It's, I mean, I love it. The name is exactly what it says. So whatever they've promised, they deliver on it. So for me, Xero and SimplePay is probably two of the best solutions out there. If you're still on VIP and Pastel, please look at moving. You might think it's working for you as an organization, but it's because you don't know what else is available out there to you. So that resistance to change is a big thing in organizations, especially nonprofits, because the person in finance has probably been there for a while, or the new person in finance has just taken over from the other person, and this is what we've been doing, so they don't want to change things around, but you have to now look at forward. You have to look at technology and how can it assist your organization, because obviously it's saving time. I mean, 2 weeks ahead of deadline, that means our staff was available to do other work, which means it's more efficient for us as a business. So as an organization, if you're freeing up your admin person, because they are also doing lots of other things. I know finance in a nonprofit is generally finance, HR, office manager, everything all rolled in one, because most people don't have the funds to have multiple people or to have the right level. So obviously look at what can make that person's life a little bit easier.
Absolutely.
Just one last point. I know time is obviously essence, but I think the important thing about some of these solutions is that you know, the pricing, and obviously as organizations, you know, you should be price sensitive, and rightfully so, is that it generally costs a lot less than your old legacy software that you pay for. The subscription models are generally month to month as well. You know, and you have different tiered packages, which is suitable to your organization. I think that's quite important. And even the transition which you asked in terms of the moving over from a software, from a desktop software, generally all of these platforms have some sort of functionality which allows the historical data to actually be brought through as well quite easily. So you're not losing any of that data.
Perfect. Jazakallah. I know I'm stuck for time, and as I mentioned at the beginning, almost every single discussion here can be unpacked in a workshop, and I think a lot more time is needed. And we've got a commitment, alhamdulillah, from our barakah to do that. I think the one thing that we can definitely take from this is change is inevitable. And no matter what we're doing, we know that it's changing consistently, the environments are changing, and very often we get stuck in organizations and in positions, and we think it's worked all this time, it will continue working. Now's the time to bring in a lot more youngsters from our communities who are geared up to be able to do this, to be able to transition us easily so we're effective organizations. And the truth of it is efficiency that we need in our organizations, and it does cost money. So very often we say, oh, we take absolutely no admin costs, but the truth of it is somebody is covering those admin costs, and those admin costs need to be accounted for as well. And this was the one conversation that I had with Reza and Farida, and they didn't want to commit to answering, but I think maybe with all the people in this group and perhaps at the next Al Baraka workshop to talk about what should be our administration costs. Should it be for local projects? What should it be as a, for our international projects? What we should be taking into account too? Because if we have a consistent think as organizations in South Africa, as NPOs, and we're giving that to our donors know upfront what it is, because donors are now shopping around, oh, this administration cost is this, this is this, but they don't understand if you're sending a truck to Gaza, you've got administration costs in terms of logistics, manpower, time that's being there, warehousing. So I think having people sitting in this room, getting together and actually having a discussion in terms of legislating, loosely legislating, or at least stating what our administration costs could be with the backing of financial people like Al Baraka to guide that, will be something that we can put forward as an NPO in South Africa. Farida and Reza, Jazakallah. I think, as I mentioned, there's huge amounts of questions still to go through. Maybe after the session, over lunch, while we're eating, people can still come to you and have these discussions. I'm sure Al Baraka will make your details available to the participants. Thank you. But Jazakallah for coming to Johannesburg, for warming up our weather, and for providing us with much needed information. To Al Baraka Bank, Jazakallah for always coming to the forefront of change and for really coming as a community bank to make a huge difference for the community members. Jazakallah to each of you and to every single person who's taken the time out. I truly hope that you found the session beneficial and it's something that we can take home to make an impact on our organizations. Because as we mentioned at the beginning, good intention is one part. But if we're actually putting purpose behind it to ensure efficiency, we're not just safeguarding ourselves, because it's part of an NPO or an NPC or any organization, you have as much responsibility as your treasurer to ensure that this is being done. So inshallah, with things like this, we're able to safeguard our NPOs for longevity, safeguard ourselves, and most importantly, to safeguard our donors and our beneficiaries. Jazakallah khair for joining us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
And upload and do up to 500 payments in one go. I know Zubairia is shnori because he fought me on that to get it on. And alhamdulillah, we got it on the system. And a lot of our NPOs are now starting to use SimplePay, and it's working so well. The ease and, I mean, the governance behind it is excellent. So I think very, very well done on your guys' presentation there. I'm going to move on to the next panel, which is based on banking solutions. I'm going to welcome our GM of Retail, South Africa, Nasser Sidat, who is going to host the panel.
Assalamu alaikum and good morning or good afternoon. This is a closing session, not too long. We have to pay for lunch, so we have to talk about it a little bit. Yeah, if I can just call up Wasim, who's our National Head for Business Banking, and also want to introduce Darren from Adumo, and we'll explain what Adumo is very soon. Thanks, Reza and Farida and Saira, for that excellent, it's a lot of notes being taken. I think looking forward to the next session as well, and the Cape Town and Johannesburg. And if you've got teams out in Durban and Cape Town, these sessions are going to happen in those towns as well, so we can have that linked up. I think just very quickly, in terms of, okay, we spoke about some corporate governance and how we can bring this into our day-to-day workings on the NPO. And maybe I'd start with Wasim. And Wasim, we spoke about corporate governance, but how do we manage, how can we manage risk using internet banking and those type of new systems that are out right now?
I think that's an excellent question. You know, right now there's so much of
fraud and issues that are going on in terms of internet banking. A number of the banks have introduced systems called corporate banking, where you have a multiple level user system. So for example, based on what Albaraka Bank has, we have a system which allows you up to 40 users with profiles of capturer, approval level one, approval level two, and a super user. How this works is you can set up any individual as a certain profile, for example, a capturer will capture the payment. The first approver, if you want double approval, you can have double approver. Or if you want, you can give someone access to do a payment which will automatically go off as a super user. I think those are the type of tools that have been going around and been working very well for a lot of the NPOs right now.
Yeah, so I think in essence, obviously, the different levels of approvers, the capturer, the super user, or this corporate governance in terms of it, in terms of going back, going doing an audit, who released the payment, who captured the payment. I think these are important tools that we can then use. I want to welcome Darren, and Darren is part of the Adumo group, who's recently partnered with Albaraka with certain cashless solutions. And maybe Darren, to start, maybe just for the audience, what is Adumo and who is Adumo?
Yeah. So Adumo is actually a consolidation of a number of payments companies. I think what we've seen over the years is there's been a lot of these payment companies that have just crept up all over the place. We've got a 20-year history, although the brand itself is only 4 years old at this stage. But what we pride ourselves on is the fact that we offer end-to-end payment solutions. And what that really means is that often we talk about point of sale. I don't think that's something that that would interest you guys. But we provide a card machine. So we talk about card present transactions where someone is able to pay with a card at a particular point. And we also talk about card not present transactions, which I think will be quite a bit of interest for this audience, where we do online transactions that would go straight into your Albaraka bank account. We also provide personalized service. I think that's where we have found a lot of similarity between ourselves and Albaraka, is that personalized service at the end of the day. But most importantly, our motto or our tagline or brand promise, if you want to call it that, is being a catalyst for growth. And that is something that we are very, very proud of. We've gotten feedback in the market in general just about how the solutions with the various companies that we've brought under one roof has been able to grow businesses in many, many a sense. When you talk about grow business, making it easy for your customers or for your patrons to pay. And obviously, you know, I mean, there's lots of white papers out there saying where it's easy to pay, they will come back and pay again. So that's what.
So just sticking on that, maybe from an NPO point of view, what are some of the NPO solutions that are Islamic bodies, non-profits in terms of using for payments, and then maybe touch a little on the cashless payments as well.
So, I mean, we want cashless environments, right? South Africa, unfortunately, is a hotbed for crime. NPOs in general are, what we have seen, have become very soft targets in that sense. So you don't really want to carry cash on your premises. And that's the first thing, is how do we create a cashless environment at an NPO? So that we have a number of customers that have, in fact, just down the road, Jay, we've got a customer called Pantry. And Pantry are a completely cashless environment. So we want to eliminate the need for cash. Cash is expensive to deposit into bank accounts, and it's not efficient, right? It doesn't allow the accountability associated with some sort of electronic transaction, whether that be an EFT or whether that be an actual card payment. So that's the first thing. The second thing is from an NPO perspective, we've done quite a bit from, you know, introspection in terms of how do we support organizations. And funny enough, we've had a lot of opportunity over the last few months, just around some of it through Albaraka, in supporting NPOs in itself. One of the things that we do pride ourselves on again are these tailored payment solutions. So we would want to sit down with you guys. We would want to understand exactly what your needs are. And on that basis, we would come up with a solution specifically tailored to the business. What we have seen over the years, we're very much about growth, even internally. We get asked a lot, how are we going to scale this? And the truth is, it becomes very difficult because of the personalized service that we offer. Everything is bespoke at the end of the day, and with good reason, right? No two businesses are identical. So we would look at that and we would come up with a solution specific to that. But my advice at this stage, reading some of the newspaper reports, is how do you go cashless and how do you make it easy for your patrons to pay across money into your bank account, your Al Baraka bank account. Yeah.
Thanks.
If I can just add on to that, our partnership with Adumo was very strategic on a number of things, but from an NPO perspective, everyone nowadays doesn't carry cash. If you ask anyone to donate, they say, I don't have cash, but you can give me your details. So often we give them the EFT details. What happens? They go home, they forget about it, they don't transfer. This card machine changes the game for NPOs as well. The ability to say, no, it's fine, tap your phone here. You can donate immediately. I mean, these type of digital enhancements are coming through when people are moving away from cash. This is why card payment solutions are so important for NPOs as well. I mean, these are mentioned, the 10 bucks only. Those are new digital enhancements that are coming to try and get those type of donations. You don't want to lose out on any cent, and this fills that gap.
I think together with that, you're looking at QR codes, you're looking at internet bank website, codes online to go and click links and make payments. And we're hoping just when we end, Darren, to give something back to the NPOs in terms of some offer, inshallah.
Yeah.
Wasim, just to touch a little bit on it, not too much in detail, maybe just to touch, we're seeing now a lot of donations happening overseas, the corporate governance that goes with it. Obviously, from a banking point of view, we're dealing with it. It goes through a process. Maybe just to highlight, what are some of the steps that needs to be taken when an NPO needs to do a donation overseas?
Yeah, so in the last couple of years, everyone would have noticed that the Reserve Bank has come down very strongly on NPOs to do transfers overseas. I mean, everyone, a lot of NPOs are doing collections for Gaza, the Turkey earthquakes. And in order to send this money overseas, it's becoming extremely more difficult. The Reserve Bank wants to see where the money is going to and it is not used in a fraudulent manner. So what they've done is they've increased their security. So from an NPO perspective, if you're ever planning to do transfers overseas, start the process in advance. It does take up to 10 days because the Reserve Bank has to approve each payment that is being done overseas. Requirements that are needed is your basic requirements, your financials or background history of the NPO, what type of projects you are affiliated with. And then the NPO that is receiving the money on the other side, it has to be another NPO that's receiving the money overseas. It cannot be an individual account. And the NPO on that side, the more information you can provide to the Reserve Bank actually makes the process for approval much more faster and easier. And there is a fee of it, unfortunately, which is 650. It's not a Baraka fee. It's a Reserve Bank fee, which we have to pay to them. And that's basically to get approval for your payment. So I think the requirement is as much information on your NPO as well as the NPO overseas. That's most important, financial background history type of projects. And then also just give it at least 15 days in advance before that payment is going to reach overseas.
Thanks, Wasim. And our team can help with those Reserve Bank approvals, etc. And we do have a Forex department that does that. I think just before we close, there were two more questions. Wasim, we spoke about, I don't like to talk about COVID, but COVID was there. And the need to go away from a voucher system. The need to go away from cash. Obviously, we recently introduced a new product on this. Maybe if you can just touch a little bit on that.
Yeah, so I think a number of banks have started trying to introduce social contribution cards. Al Baraka Bank has introduced one in the past year, and it's an excellent product. Ours is a bit above the rest in terms of Sharia and what we provide as a product. So our social contribution card is aimed at removing the voucher system. Again, everything moving away from paper, going towards digital. You will be able to open up individual accounts for these recipients who you want to give your hampers or zakat to, and we'll issue them with cards. What are the security purposes on an NPO side? we created a card that will only be able to be utilized at Sharia compliant vendors. So for example, your supermarkets, your butchers, your petrol station, if they have to swipe it at a bar, it wouldn't work. If they have to swipe it at a casino, it wouldn't work. The card is restricted to only swiping, so they can go to an ATM, you won't be able to remove cash from there. Those are some of the benefits of these cards. So basically, if you have anyone, instead of doing a voucher system, what we do is we'll send out our consultants to you, we'll open up accounts for them as a social contribution card, and you can then EFT the money into there every month. If they wish, they can then give you access to the account, which you can pull statements and view where the transactions have been made, for example, if you want to. But that is obviously between the NPO and the recipient itself. But it's an excellent product. There's no monthly fee. There's no swiping fee. It's free of charge. So basically, there's no fees associated. So the recipient is not going to incur any charges. Basically, if you put in 100 rand, they're going to be able to utilize 100 rand. So this is a fantastic product that we launched. I think do get in touch with our consultants if it's something that would work for your NPO.
Thanks. Thanks, Wasim, for that. Maybe in conclusion, maybe what can we offer our clients, and yeah, maybe some closing remarks from your side.
Yeah, so you know, for us, it really is about the solution, you know. So we are currently working on specifically one of the things that we own inside the Adumo space are two point of sale companies, and this is something that was brought by Al Baraka to our attention. Was specifically, you know, how do we create almost kiosk type of environment where, you know, someone could just walk up and they could select, okay, we want to donate 100 rand and be able to tap their watch or their phone or, you know, maybe do a scan for a payment. So that's something that's in the works. We are actually engaged quite heavily with those companies at the moment. But the main thing is you mentioned being cost effective. We always look at competing with the big retail banks in terms of cost. What I can say is that we will come under 2% on transactions quite easily. Just to get going, in the past, we have looked at things like free machine rental for a period of time as well. Nasir mentioned the QR code payments. So those are what we call card not present transactions, although you're scanning it with your cell phone. Bear in mind there's a difference between a tap transaction and a transaction that is scanned by your actual cell phone, called scan to pay. That's a standard, unfortunately, of 2.75%. But what it talks to is that you don't have to carry your wallet around with you in order to pay. And I think that's where everything is going now in terms of payment ease, is you don't necessarily need to have a card in order to do a transaction. One of the other things that we are at the absolute forefront of, we have directors that sit on the Payment Association board. I'm sure you guys have heard of it. It's called PayShap. PayShap is basically the ability to transfer in real time money into a person's bank account by simply utilizing their cell phone number, which is that's the ultimate, right? You plug in the cell phone number on your app, and you're able to send a transaction that way. It's not available for businesses as yet, but that's something that will be available on our card machines as well. We've got quite a nice Africa footprint, particularly in our neighboring countries. We've also been able to integrate wallet payments, which is quite prevalent in some of our neighboring countries in terms of the choice way to pay. Things like e-wallet, you'd be able to accept those at point of sale itself. We were recently acquired by a company called Lusaka. Wasim was actually in a meeting with one of our sister companies now this morning, and that solution is going to be ever changing. They say the more things change, the more things stay the same. So, you know, cards are going to be around for a long time. Cash is going to be around for a long time. We are also looking specifically at partnering with other companies within the group to bring about more of a holistic offering specifically to our clientele and prospective customers, you know, where we would even be able to manage some of the cash sales at the end of the day. But the message that I think I'm trying to get across is we've got a sales team that's countrywide. We base countrywide. You know, we would love the opportunity to come through and see you, to understand exactly what it is that your needs are at that particular point, and then we would be able to advise accordingly. But from my guarantee, those transaction rates will be under 2% on average. Yeah.
So we actually have started the process. We've done a number of NPOs already who we've brought on the point of sale side. If anyone has a business, you'll know in the industry, point of sale rates on your debit and credit card varies from the type of the amount, the volumes that go through. So the higher the amount, 1 million rand, you could be swiping for example, 0.85% on a debit card, whereas 10,000 rand, you'll pay 2.75 on a debit card transaction. But what Adumo has done in the last couple of interactions we've had with NPOs, they've provided them with rates for NPOs that swipe from a little less, 20, 30,000 rand a month. They've given them rates that are offered to clients who swipe 1 million rand in a business. So the rates are very, very competitive. They've gone out to say, this is what we want to offer NPOs. And it's going well so far. Alhamdulillah, it's very, very affordable. And I think it's allowing NPOs to now utilize the full funds and not pay so much transaction fees.
Thanks. Really appreciate it. And Darren, Wasim, I'll be around after to have a chat. I think just to close from my side, I think Riza spoke about salaries and paying to staff. I think it's important as NPOs, we know the value of our team members within, and we can't tick without the team around us. And I think now there's so much of Sharia compliant solutions for staff members, like a Sharia compliant provident fund. We had a case recently, and we've been paying, like example, Al Baraka, we contribute towards a provident fund. We've now got a Sharia compliant provident fund that we can put in for NPOs. And you only need to start with a minimum of 5 staff. I mean, it's when somebody leaves the organization, they leave with something. I think it's also a way to retain the talent and retain staff with so much of historic knowledge. Talk to us about that. We've got a specialist financial advisor that can set up the super funds, retirement plans for your staff. Also staff that may be renting a property for 10 years or 20 years and going to nothing. We're now offering property finance up to 30 years, vehicle finance. So there's a whole host of solutions that we can provide. Wasim's our national business banking manager. Adila Soni is our retail manager here in Gauteng. And the team is here. And inshallah, we can engage with you after. Jazakallah. I'll call upon Ismail Yusuf to do the closing. Thank you.
Okay, assalamu alaikum. Jazakallah to all of you. We finished on time, so that's great. I know when Mohammed Kaka started speaking, he's speaking about robots. And we also saw that on your video as well. So that seems to be a very prominent theme on your side. And I think from Riza and Farida, when they're talking about the IT side of things, I think you could have been forgiven for thinking that today's seminar was on IT itself. But I think that's the reality that, you know, everything is moving at a very rapid pace. And I noticed that you were also making notes on your writing pads. We apologize, we couldn't give you iPads as such. But there's a story to the writing pads, right? And Nasser, I have to say this. So these writing pads were not here today, or rather from yesterday. And so Nasser decided that because I was traveling this morning, that I should bring these writing pads. But not realizing how heavy this pack of writing pads were, that bringing it in my bag, I did pull a muscle on this idea, Nasser. So he's promised to arrange for a massage for me later on. But nonetheless, I'm happy that you found this beneficial, and I hope that you did, because I did see a lot of you making copious notes, and I'm sure that from what has been said earlier on, we definitely need more of these sessions. And there's so much that needs to be unpacked. And we thought that, you know, running organizations, NPOs, the easy part is actually going out and, you know, just collecting the money and distributing to, you know, disadvantaged cases and people that are deserving of it. The real and hard work, ironically, lies on the back office, on the admin side, in the accounting and the IT and taxation. Wow. And who would have thought that taxation would play such an important role in running organizations? And we must thank Reza and Farida, our special guests from Durban, for sharing with us these insights. And we really, I think, learned a lot, especially on tax exemption. I don't think any organization really thought about that. The benefits and savings that we could, realize from, registering for tax. So thank you so much for sharing that with us. The Section 18A, issues that have been spoken about, what is applicable, what is not, and really there's so much to be learned from that. So I think from my side, I just want to say thank you very much to each and every one of you for attending this function this afternoon. Really appreciate your support, and that's the most important thing. From an Albaraka point of view, you see our advertising line that says your partner bank, and we mean that in every sense. Firstly, our partnership with yourselves. And the fact that you're supporting us and you've attended here this afternoon is really appreciated. Our partnership with the service providers, like Odumo as an example. And also want to thank Darren. Where is Darren? Thank you. Darren, thank you very much for being here this afternoon. Thank you. I must say in Durban, and you probably are familiar with the North Beach Musalla, the Jamaat Khana, every Friday after Jummah, Mr. Mohammed Iqbal Mather, people, you're probably familiar with him, makes an announcement. There's collections taking place outside, and if you don't have any cash, there's a card machine as well. And there's somebody that's there, standing with the card machine waiting. So you really don't have any excuse not to contribute as such. But it really is making a difference. And I think Waseem made the point that somebody says, send me your banking details, and then that's forgotten, and he never makes a deposit thereafter. So as you can see, this is changing, this is evolving, and we have to embrace that change. Whether we like it or not, that's the way the world is moving, and we have to do so. So in conclusion, I want to thank our panelists, Reza Amra from Durban. We actually go to the same masjid in Durban. I haven't seen you there recently. I'm joking. Farida Labangi, thank you so much. Also, very insightful presentation. Zaira Bam for facilitating that session. Thank you. Really appreciate your presence here as well and the support that you've given us. Much appreciated. Thank you so much. To Nasser and the team that presented the second round, to Waseem, our program director for today. You might have noticed that Waseem has got a slightly swollen lip. No, nothing happened domestically, we assure you. You used the wrong lipstick, the one that actually gives you more volume. Sorry for that. Thank you, Mohammed, for giving us the opening. Qari Bashir, shukran for reciting the opening qiraat as well. And to everyone, Jazakallah, thank you very much for your attendance. Please do stay and engage with the rest of the team members. And there is snacks also still available as well. Shukran, Jazakallah, Assalamu Alaikum.